nails, they're going to stick you in, you know. I was so grateful. You know, my son drove me there, and as soon as I got there, the nurse was waiting for me, and they put me the gown and the mask, and I went in there, and the nurse goes, "You got 5 minutes," and I looked at her and go, "Okay." And I looked at my wife, and she looked at me, crying, we had tears, and we kissed each other. She wanted to kiss me and take her mask off. I told her, I was just so grateful, and I told her, "Let me pray for you." And I prayed, and we prayed together. And you know what? That is God. You know, that He was letting me have that 5 minutes of my life. And the nurse came in, and she goes, "You got one more minute." And we looked at each other. And I told my wife, I said, "If I think like your husband to you." And she looked at me, and she goes, "You have been a terrific husband."
A shame.
And then we cried again. As I was walking out, my wife said, please, take care of my grandson, Noah, you know. And I looked at my wife, and I said, "Don't worry, Claudia, I'll take care of him." You know? And, it was late. On my way, I called the chapel. It was like chapel, and I went in there and I prayed to God, and I said, "Lord, you know, you're gonna take my life. Just give me my heart.
Ha ha ha!
gentle spirit. She was really quiet, like in the way she loved.
About my mom, so I've kind of been just listening to what's been said and thinking about what hasn't been said, and I guess some of what hasn't been touched on is that my mom was a miracle. So I don't know how many of you guys know this, but my mom was born with a coronary heart defect, so she wasn't supposed to live all that long, and growing up she was always didn't have as much energy as all of the other kids, but my mom was spunky and she dug deep and found a way to keep up with all of the other kids and do what needed to be done. When she was 13 or 14, her heart caught up with her and she had to go into surgery. And while they were operating on her, my mom coded, so her heart basically stopped, and the doctors didn't think that they were going to be able to bring her back, but my grandfather, he prayed, he made some trades with God, and so did a lot of other people, and somehow she recovered, and she walked out of the hospital, and then, I don't know exact time, but I know once, 2 years, she needed some more surgery. Again, it didn't turn out too well for her, but she was again, her heart coded, and they didn't think she was going to make it, but somehow she dug deep, and my mom was a fighter, and she found a way to walk out of the hospital again. And they told my mom that she wasn't ever going to have any kids. But somehow she had three of us, my sister, my brother, and myself, we're all here. So my mom's life is one that's characterized by a lot of miracles. And so I know when just with everything that's going on, sometimes it seems like miracles that we need. They're kind of far away. But I just, like my mom's life reminded everybody that, you know, our God is a God of love, and that's why she was capable of incredible love. Also, our God is a God of miracles, and that's why me and my siblings are here, and that's why I look out here and so many lives are touched when they shouldn't have been, because she and God somehow made it so that she could still be here and do what she did. And like I said, I thank you guys for all being here and being part of that miracle. Now, I lost the program, but my daughters are supposed to come up and read their poem, so we're going to do that.
Butterfly stand there?
Yeah.
Oh, what's next to you?
Crazy. I would have thought they'd fly away.
Can you bring it close to the camera? Can you bring it close to the camera? This camera.
Oh, where's focus? Got it. Cool.
All right, thank you.
I got it on video.
This is my own little short story of Laura. Was I remember the first time I met her was at church, and she definitely let me know who the alpha was in the family, and man, I was scared to see her again after that. I told Beauty, I was like, it's going to take a while, so, but then, you know, she invited me to her house, and we sat in the living room for 3 hours just talking like we had been friends for years. I mean, it was just amazing how she could just reach out to people, and what everyone was saying is so true about her. She just had a heart of gold, and, you know, I'm going to miss her. You know, I didn't know her for long, but, man, I've cried so much. It's like losing my own mom, and it's been really hard for the entire family, the Munoz family, but the overwhelming love and support that all of you guys have shown on Facebook, and, you know, making sure that they had food, just little things like that go a long way. And so I just wanted to thank you guys from the bottom of my heart for showing that love and support to the family. So let's go ahead and just pray in closing, okay? Lord God, we come before you to give you thanks for this special day that you've allowed us to have in memory of Laura. Laura had a very special impact on our lives, and we trust that she's now before you, and we know she's in your presence, Lord. God, you are so good to us, and even through these moments of sorrow, you bring joy to our hearts by uniting us under you, the one true God. We ask you, Lord Heavenly Father, to bless everyone here today and continue to remind us of your everlasting love and grace. We thank you for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. And so that concludes.
I think the last time we came here was before. Yeah.
I'm glad
you came.
What is it doing?
I'm asking for
cross country and be like, hey, bring your neck in the town.
Yeah. Let me try with the flash.
We love traffic.
Beauty more to your right, don't type. I want to see beauty.
One, two, three.
No, her name is beauty.
Alex, look.
If you harder to smile.
What? He's gonna pay.
It's like tempting.
I'm just waiting for my
like once you throw some dollar bills out there, maybe.
All right, here you go. Look here.
Plato de
los sí, claro que sí.
Voy a ver las estrellas.
We're coming to visit you, live with you, because we don't have any place to go. So.
It's certainly been the
years.
My sister moved to Washington, so
oh yeah.
So she was really feeling like very far away from everybody, kind of shut down from everything.
Yeah, she's married well.
Gretchen still lives here in.
So what are you doing?
She still lives here in Riverside. My older sister.
Your older sister.
Little baby shop.
Can you get that glove out of your mouth, huh?
Cute. Cool.
But it's good. But it's good if we get it. Yeah, you know. But we're good though. If you guys want, yeah. Yeah, we got it for video. We're good though. We're good. Yeah, we're good.
Bless you. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
But if you guys, no, you could just mingle, talk, laugh. Just look happy. Yeah, just look happy.
We apologize for that.
You're good.
Hi.
Hello. I'm just gonna get you guys messing around.
Thank you.
Fast or slow?
Fast.
I fell over.
Spin or no spin?
No spin.
Okay.
Once I fell off the trailer.
You might hit the tree.
We don't have any time, and we don't know what it is.
I can time. I have a watch.
Oh, thank you.
I have a time.
I'm going to suffer because
of you. Don't go fast. It was Aaliyah's turn. Maggie, it's Aaliyah's turn.
Wait,
I'm here. Maggie, you haven't been in the line.
Yeah,
you can.
Okay, next.
Here's your stick.
Thank you.
And I better not hit it because it's a really hard stick.
Hike. Pretty much, yeah. All right, you guys are good. Thank you. Cool. Got it. Okay.
Yeah.
Is anybody home?
Always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Let's pray. Father, we thank you once again for the treasure that we had in the Lord, the privilege we have to work with her, to walk with her, to live with her, to enjoy her. Thank you for how forcefully and clearly you showed your love to us, the love of your Son, through her life well lived. May we rejoice in the joy that she has obtained and look forward to that day when we'll be able to share it with her. We thank you so much. I look to you in Jesus' name. Amen. And I'll pass the remainder of my time to the esteemed orator known as Schumann. Are you prepared, Nomad? Schumann? Schumann? Prefer Schumann? Noah Schumann. I will pass it to him. Don't mess this up, man. I have a bad feeling about it.
Thank you.
was walking the hall alone. My wife said, please, be careful of my grandson. And I looked at my wife and said, we're very funny. And it was late.
No. all have special thoughts of who Laura was to you. And for me, she was a gem. She really was. She was my sister-in-law and she was my friend. And I love Laura. You know, like they say, you know, sometimes we take relationships for granted. And we take our time with one another for granted. And we get mad at people and we don't want to talk to people and we don't want to call people. But that's not who Laura was. Laura really was love. And I'm going to miss her. And being here today, it just really, really... I always say, you know, I'm just... I just haven't seen her. She'll come around. And we'll see each other. Because as sister-in-law, sometimes we don't see each other all the time. Or we don't call each other all the time. But we know they're going to be there. And that's what Laura was. But this really is a reality. That Laura is in a better place. Laura is in heaven. And she's rejoicing. She's not missing us, probably. Because now she's in the presence of the Almighty. Amen. And that's the joy that we carry, that we know that she's in perfect peace. And as much as we're going to miss her, she's where she needs to be.
Supposed to live all that long, but growing up she was always
have as much energy as all of the other kids, but my mom was spunky and she dug deep and found a way to keep up with all of the other kids and do what needed to be done. When she was 13 or 14, her heart caught up with her and she had to go into surgery. And while they were operating on her, my mom coded, so she, her heart basically stopped. And the doctors didn't think that they were going to be able to bring her back. But my grandfather, he prayed, he made some trades with God, and so did a lot of other people, and somehow she recovered, and she walked out of the hospital, and then I don't know exactly how long, but I know months to her, she went through surgeries, siblings are here, and that's why I look out here and so many lives are touched when they shouldn't have been, because she and God somehow made it so that she could still be here and do what she did. And like I said, I thank you guys for all being here and being a part of that miracle. I think now I lost the program, but my daughters are supposed to come up and read their poem, so we're gonna do that.
Thank you. Hello?
Alright, so I just wanted to say thank you guys for coming out. Just my own little short story of Laura was, I remember the first time I met her was at church, and she definitely let me know who the alpha was in the family. And I was scared to see her after that. I told Beauty, I was like, it's going to take a while. So, but then, you know, she invited me to her house, and we sat in the living room for 3 hours just talking, like we've been friends for years. I mean, it was just amazing how she could just reach out to people, and what everyone was saying was so true about her. She just had a heart of gold, and you know, I'm gonna miss her. You know, I didn't know her for long, but man, I've cried so much. It's like losing my own mom. It's been really hard for the entire family, the Munoz family, but the overwhelming love and support that all of you guys have shown on Facebook, and you know, making sure that they had food and just little things like that go a long way, and so I just wanted to thank you guys from the bottom of my heart for showing that love and support to the family. So let's go ahead and just pray and close the prayer. Lord God, we come before you to give you thanks for this special day that you've allowed us to have in memory of Laura. Laura had a very special impact on our lives, and we trust that she's now before you, and we know she's in your presence, Lord. God, you are so good to us, and even through these moments of sorrow, you bring joy to our hearts by uniting us under you, one true God. We ask you, Lord Heavenly Father, to bless everyone here today and continue to remind us of your everlasting love and grace. We thank you for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name.
ya de las damas. Le dije que nosotros simplemente hablamos de lo mal que nos pasaron.
Oh, for the food, you guys could go. Yeah, no worries. Oh, I think it's actually not open yet right now. Yeah, they just asked us to film it and then cover it real quick. Yeah, I just took off the sign just real quick. Gee, I felt bad. I felt bad doing that. I didn't want to do it. So many flips. I'm gonna get one wide real quick. Getting a sugar rush just looking at it. Okay, two more and then we're done because causing too much attention.
One more.
Cool. Yes, sir.
I'll wait.
Yeah, you guys are more than welcome to go there.
Chili pepper.
We got it. We got it.
This guy can do it, right? Take our picture.
Photographer's right there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Hey, wait a minute.
One, two, and three. One more.
Right at this camera, guys. Right at this camera.
One, two, and all right. Thank you, guys.
Cool, you guys.
All right, looking here. Gotta fix that hair. There you go. I wanna get one with. All right, looking here.
Yeah, at this camera, you guys.
All right, here we go. One, two, and three. Two more. Last one. One, two, and thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
You could do wonders with all the.
Sorry. No, I'm sorry. I'm getting the. Yeah, you're good. You're good.
I think I should. Sorry. No, they're all like in there.
I do photography, just called it.
And then, if you need another table, we can put maybe another table. Set up right here, and then table, if you need the table.
I know.
and to live in sinking, desperate depression over staggering failures in the next moment. Right? How did she manage that? How do we manage that? Right? 1 John tells us, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, for God is love." So how do we have this love? God is love. Love comes from God. Well, we're supposed to love other people. God is love. Love comes from God. We're supposed to love. How? Still, how? Right? How did she receive this love? She had it because she desperately knew she needed it. Right? Even though she knew the depths of the all-perfect love of her all-knowing, all-benevolent, all-forgiving Creator, right? She knew that she was a sinner. She was out without right or capacity to receive or to know or to be deserving of this love. Now you should be like, come on, this is her kittens or beating the homeless with wiffle ball bats? I mean, right? Yet James tells us, for whoever keeps the whole law yet stumbles in one point, he has become guilty of all. It doesn't take a lot to fall short of us. We do this pretty quickly. Our first no to our parents, right? We break God's law when he tells us, honor your father and mother. Right? That's why our first word is no. I mean, really fall that short of our Creator and his will and his love for us. Right? And it is especially, it's difficult for us to receive this. Right? It is now offensive. And says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Laura lived for the hope of heaven, assured to her by her faith, a hope that she has now obtained. As much as we are hurt and miss her, as we miss so many that we have lost in this past year, we can rejoice in this, that she has received the hope of heaven that she longed for. As a pastor and hero of mine, Peter John Corson, he had several face-to-face encounters with death, and lost only once. And he shared once this really near-prophetic, mind-blowing insight that I've really missed reading the scriptures over the years. And, are you ready? You've got to write this down. Just see if you're paying attention here. So I'm only going to say it once, and not very clearly. And it's this, that heaven is fun. Heaven is a feast, a delight, a joyous dance. We can rejoice that those who have this hope can share it with her and rejoice with her. May her love, faith, and hope in the grandchildren and all those whose lives she's touched and lives on in their lives and in the memory of her. May those of us who don't yet have this faith and hope consider the true weight of the reality that was ever present and evident in her life. In her love towards the remain, we'll be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Let's pray. Father, we thank you once again for the treasure that we had in Laura. The privilege we had.
I just forgot, I was so tired today. She came here. I forgot to ask her for me. And they tell me, she's, oh, you're longer than what you usually get. I was like, yes. So you're usually it's also because of my own. So when I go, I'll ask her. It's beautiful. I can't wait. I was like, oh,
they'll be fine. All right, I'll be back.
There was only five of them.
We'll find out.
See, there's your dad. He can check that address.
Oh, see.
Hello everybody. So I guess we're gonna start. So I get this thing on the road. I think no mic on. There you go. Can you hear me now? All right. I'd like to thank all you guys for showing up. My mom is a very special person. I think about Jeremiah 1:5, before I formed you in the womb, I knew you before you were born. I sanctified you, I ordained you as a prophet to the nation. I think how God ordained my mom to be a mother, and she blessed all our lives, as we can see here, everyone that showed up. And she's touched a lot of us, so her work was done. And we have the promise to see her, and we know we're going to see her. Is in 2 Samuel when David lost his son. He was like, but now that he is dead, why should I fast? Can I bring him back again? I will go to him, but he will not return to me. So we know that when we die, we're going to see my mom in heaven. We're going to see our loved ones in heaven. And we have that promise. And so I'm going to open us up in prayer. And then we'll get the show on the road. Lord Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for being our God. Lord, you know it is to lose a son, for you sent your son on the cross to die for our sins, and he risen 3 days later. Lord, thank you for the blessings that you have bestowed us. Thank you for our families, our loved ones, and the people you put in our lives to touch our lives. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Hello, everybody.
Hello.
Flesh and her shell clear.
Can everyone hear me in the back? Woo! Just give me a moment to set up a timer so I don't keep going until the sun comes down. Oh no. Watch out for the third one. I'm in trouble. Let's pray together. Father, as we look to your word and in your work in the life of Laura, may you comfort our hurts. Remind us of the treasure you had given us and the love you so generously poured out into our lives through her, Lord Father. We thank you for her warmth, the way she touched us all, Lord Father, who was a faithful ambassador of your love. Amen. So before I begin in the scripture, I just thank you so much for coming out here and to share in the memory and the life of Laura. So, 1 Corinthians 13 says that if I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all that I have and deliver up my body to be burned, but I have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It doesn't insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When as I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So now faith, hope, and love abide these three. But the greatest of these is love. Miroslava Laura Munoz possessed faith, hope, and above all, love. Born April 26, 1959, passed January 14th, 2021. Beloved daughter of Albino and Luz Silva, sister of Nicole Silva, wife of Ronald S. Munoz, mother of Ronald Jr., Daniel, Gloria, Patricia, Judy, grandmother of Noah Schumann, Alexander, Madeline, and Isabella Munoz. So last month, Cindy and the kids and I were visiting the Munoz family at Grandma Luz's house, and we were just sitting back in the backyard and reminiscing about Laura, even though we tried not to in the beginning, I think. Right? And it was interesting just how quickly we just... everything came back to how she poured out her love as a mom to other people. And it didn't matter who you were, right? She was a mom biologically, she was a mom of adopted daughters by law, and she was a mom by just sheer force of her personality, right? You couldn't escape the motherly love that she exuded, right? I remember coming over here back in our college days, a couple decades ago, and just hanging out and watching how she would be just hanging out with Gloria and Nicole and Patty and Beauty and Cindy and Tiffany and Amy and other gals from our group, and just the way they would just enjoy each other's presence and each other's company, and how she just, you know, would mother them, right? And amazing, and she had two sons. She managed not to murder her two sons. She had no shortage of stories when they nearly brought her to her very end. One of my favorites, of course, is when they were small, instead of dispatching them into the void, she wisely set them on top of the refrigerator until they were ready to re-enter society. Mommy, can I come down now? Which is funny, because Ronnie tells me his daughters love being put on top of the refrigerator, so I don't know what he's going to do. But and I can bag on them, because I had a brother, and we put our parents in early graves, so So, and she was also a mom to whatever riffraff Ronnie would bring home with him, including guys like me, and Josh, and Jason, other people I know. I mean, she would just mother you. She wouldn't hesitate to start giving me lectures on how I'm rapidly aging myself and I need to do something about it. I didn't do so well at that. I'm 17! And she was a mom that had the heart of the father towards other people. And I keep thinking about this verse when I think about Laura and the Song of Moses, Deuteronomy 32. He found him in a desert land and in a waste howling wilderness. He led him about. He instructed him. He kept him as the apple of his eye. As an eagle stirreth up her nest, fluttereth over her young, spreadeth abroad her wings, taketh them, beareth them on her wings. Laura had this kind of love, the love of compassion upon broken people, right? People burnt up by the waste howling wilderness. She wouldn't hesitate to just put her arms around you, to enclose her in her embrace and enter her home, into her joy, into her humor, into her hospitality. I was looking at Ron's portrait gallery along the edge there. If you look at the very last portrait there, he has this great portrait, just an eagle just hovering over her eaglets in the nest. And that's the kind of picture I think about Laura. And this is the same kind of love that Jesus had towards people. Luke 13, he cries out, "O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, which killest the prophets, and stonest them that have sent to thee." Pretty rotten, right? "How often would I have gathered thy children together, as a hen doth gather her brood under her wings." You know, like rotten old Jerusalem, it didn't matter how many times you hurt her, disappointed her, right? Or, you know, broke her down, put her to her very end, right? She was the kind of person who would be with open wings of compassion, let her back into your life, to forgive you, to extend to her warmth, emptying herself, right? That kind of love. Like Jesus says to the widow of Nain, Luke tells us about the widow of Nain, when the Lord saw her, he had compassion upon her and said to her, "Weep not." Laura had that kind of superpower spidey sense. She could look on you and tell when you were hurting, right? She could speak that word of compassion into you. Right? You'd have a hard time hiding it. She could tell. Right? I mean, right? You'd almost, right? So think about this one. So Matthew tells us, Jesus called his disciples unto him and said, "I have compassion on the multitude because they continue with me now 3 days and have nothing to eat. And I will not send them away fasting, lest they faint in the way." And this is definitely the kind of love that Laura had. I don't think anyone left the Munoz home hungry, right? Maybe a little over, provisioned on the way out the door, right? But it wasn't just her fridge that she would empty out for you. She would empty out herself to you, her time and energy. And like most of us, she had a limited ration of time and energy. And yet, she would dump that out for other people, sacrificially, right? So it brings up the question, right? Where did she get this love from? How did she manage it? How did she carry out the love of Jesus when she clearly was not Jesus, right? She had her faults, like the rest of us. She had her struggles and shortcomings as a daughter, a wife, a mother, a friend, a co-worker. Like all of us, right? How did she manage to have this love? How did she manage, unlike King Saul, to live a life of pride one moment over small victories, and then to live in sinking, desperate depression over staggering failures in the next moment, right? How did she manage that? How do we manage that? Right? 1 John tells us, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, for God is love." So how do we have this love? God is love. Love comes from God. And we're supposed to love other people. God is love. Love comes from God. We're supposed to love. How? Right? How did she receive this love? She had it because she desperately knew she needed it, right? Even though she knew the depths of the all-perfect love of her all-knowing, all-benevolent, all-forgiving Creator, right? She knew that she was a sinner. She was out without right or capacity to receive or to know or to be deserving of this love. Now you should be like, come on, this is her remembrance, right? You're kind of talking down on her now. It's kind of mean. What horrible thing did she do so unworthy to receive God's love? I remember her boiling and eating kittens or beating the homeless with wiffle ball bats. I mean, right? Yet James tells us, "For whoever keeps the whole law yet stumbles in one point, he has become guilty of all." Right? It doesn't take a lot to fall short of us. We do this pretty quickly. With our first no to our parents, right? We break God's law when he tells us, honor your father and mother. Right? That's why our first word is no. I mean, really fall that short of our Creator and his will and his love for us. Right? And it is especially, it's difficult for us to receive this. Right? It is now offensive for some people to be called a sinner. To look into the reality that we are a sinner. Yet Laura was not willing to be offended by the reality she could not avoid. The reality she could not ignore. She knew she was a sinner. She knew who she sinned against. She knew her sins was against an all-powerful Creator. And a perfect and loving law that she fell short of. Romans 6:23 bluntly tells us that the wages of sin is death. She knew the consequences of her sin. Right? Yet she faced who she was before God. She faced the consequences of her sin before God without avoiding it. Faith, hope, and love. Laura had these. And the faith is in the promise embedded in the brutal statements of Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. 1 Timothy tells us, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for all, to be testified in due time. It was to the cross of Christ, his payment for her shortcomings, him directly, him personally, that Laura placed her faith in and put her hope towards. So you, the times we're in, one of the hot conversations I keep getting involved in, and I can't seem to avoid it. Should I get a vaccine? Should I not get a vaccine? Ah! Right? And like, I keep fighting myself in these arguments. Right? And I get really tempted at times, like, well, let's ask Maura Munoz. What would she say about should you have a COVID vaccine? Right? So I'm tempted to do this, but I think, what would Laura say? She would kind of flutter her eyes at me, right? Probably thwack me across the head in the way she could when I'm getting too ridiculous, which is pretty often, right? And tell me I'm missing the big picture. I'm missing the big point. Ray Comfort once turned this, I heard this statistic from him once. Death kills 10 out of 10 people. It's a pretty all-encompassing statistic. It sounds like a gross estimation. So me, I'm not a pastor. I'm not really a person. I'm an engineer. So I had to go and run the numbers. And it turns out for both the years, 2019, 2020, and in 2021, death still kills 10 out of 10 people. As it turns out, there is no available vaccine for being flattened by an 18-wheeled semi. There is no vaccine for 17 stab wounds in the back, which is kind of what I'm expecting. Right? Even if you manage to make it to the ripe old age of 120, there is no vaccine for the fact that you're way outside your manufacturer's warranty. And you ain't getting a renewal. Right? Acts 4:12. Right? Right? So what vaccine would Laura have us really occupy our minds with from her perspective? For where she's at now? Acts 4:12, and there is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. The names of Pfizer, Moderna, J&J, they can't save us from the consequences of sin and death. Neither can the names of clean living, organic food, essential oils, lots of push-ups, right? No amount of stocks, bonds, Bitcoinage, right, can buy us extra time against the inevitable, right? The Apostle Paul makes it clear in Ephesians, for by grace you have been saved, through faith, and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. Laura received the free gift of God. the shed blood of Jesus Christ on the cross as the only available and effective vaccine cure for the remission of sin. The sin that has infected all of us from our failure to live up to God's perfect law. Faith, hope, and love. It is through faith in and relationship to the one mediator, Jesus Christ, that she has received her hope. But what kind of hope are we talking about here? Are we talking about, like, I hope Bill Gates remembers to think of me in his will? You know, I hope the slice of pizza doesn't give me heartburn. I hope this green tooth doesn't become a problem. Right? It's not that kind of wishy-washy hope that the Bible talks about. Hebrews 11 says, now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Laura lived for the hope of heaven, assured to her by her faith, a hope that she has now obtained. As much as we are hurt and miss her, as we miss so many that we have lost in this past year, we can rejoice in this, that she has received the hope of heaven that she longed for. So pastor and hero of mine, Peter John Corson, he had several face-to-face encounters with death and lost only once. And he shared once this really near-prophetic, mind-blowing insight that I've really missed reading the scriptures over the years. And are you ready? You've got to write this down. Just see if you're paying attention here. So I'm only going to say it once, not very clearly. And it's this, that heaven is fun. Heaven is a feast, a delight, a joyous dance. Laura has run the race and attained her hope to be in the very presence of Christ Jesus, which is why we can celebrate her life this day in all joy. We can honor her life by remembering her hope and the hope that she shared with others. We can rejoice that those who have this hope can share it with her and rejoice with her. May her love, faith, and hope in the cross of Jesus be the legacy that we remember her by. May it be the Ephesians 1 inheritance that she passes down to her children and her grandchildren and all those whose lives she's touched and lives on in their lives and in the memory of her. May those of us that don't yet have this faith and hope consider the true weight of the reality that was ever present and evident in her life, in her love towards other people. May we take full regard to how much faster the clock is running every day, so fast that the hands are turning and the calendars are flying off the pages of the calendar, right? I mean, every day I wake up, the clock is moving faster and faster and faster, right? Moses said, teach us to number our days, that we may present to you, that we may present to you a heart of wisdom, right? Don't fall for the deception and the tricks, thinking, I'll live my life to the fullest now, and then I'll walk with Jesus. Look at Laura. How much joy did she have? How much satisfaction did she have? What did she have to give up to walk with Jesus? Rather, how much treasure did she enjoy because she did not hesitate to do so? May those of us who do claim this faith and hope ask ourselves, if that weird bald-headed kid with a beard were talking about me at my memorial, would he be saying, wow, he really knew how to love people? Or would he be saying, wow, you could talk a lot about loving people, but what he really loved was tacos. I stole that joke from Pastor Mike Berry. I'm sorry, the Honorable Reverend Michael Scott Berry the First, as he asked to be quoted. So, as I close out, I want to look to 1 Thessalonians, where Paul reminds us, but we do not want you to be uninformed, brethren, about those who are asleep, so that you do not grieve as the rest who have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, it's faith, even so God will with him those who have fallen asleep with Jesus. For this we say to you by the word of the Lord, that we who are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we shall always be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with these words. Let's pray. Father, we thank you once again for the treasure that we had in Laura, the privilege we had to work with her, to walk with her, to live with her, to enjoy her. Thank you for how forcefully and clearly you showed your love to us, the love of your Son.
In the resurrection and the life.